Very fun. I think that's all the business or announcements I have. Does anybody else have any announcements before we get started or move on to the joys and concerns? Any business we need to take care of? Oh, Scott.
So it's not in the bulletin, but Breadline is this Thursday.
Oh, Breadline is this Thursday. Who's in charge of the bulletin that they didn't get that in there? Breadline this Thursday, 9:30, right? Is that when it starts? 9:30 a.m. And lots of buns and rolls left over from last week, which are going to get pitched by Thursday if you don't grab them this week. Any other announcements or business before we move on to joys and concerns? Joys and concerns this week. We're praying for the Sampson family after the passing of Chuck. Many of you knew Chuck Sampson. We've been praying for Sue Springer probably the last month or more, and Sue Springer passed as well. Praying for the Lorenz family. Many of you knew Gary. Those three families grieving this week, we'll be keeping in prayer and lifting them up this morning. Praying for the Abbotts, or at least two out of three of them, that are on their way to Texas this morning. Noah, is that right? On their way, get to spend a week with grandson Peter. So that's very exciting news, something we've been praying for. So we'll be praying for them this morning. One of the folks in our list of those battling cancer, Allison Brennan, who's a cousin to all the Canes and Vanderbeeks here. Allison had a successful lumpectomy this past week to remove a couple nodes and will begin radiation after she heals a little bit. Praying for Bob Hawkins. Many of you knew Bob. I know some of you are classmates of Bob. Is really struggling with liver cancer. He was a photographer for probably a number of folks here, did my senior pictures. I know he did a few other folks' senior pictures, but he's in Newton, right? Newton, still living in Newton,
at home,
and being cared for at home. But it's getting close to the end. Other updates. Oh, Al, we got Al's news this week. We sent out a prayer request for his three-month checkup. And they found what they think might be a small spot and a slightly elevated number. So I'm going to try to get this right, and if I don't, you correct me. Going in on July 26th for an MRI. 25th. July 25th for an MRI to see if they can find it, and if it is something, they'll use pinpoint radiation and maybe some hormone treatment to take care of it. So we'll be praying for that long month wait for you to go in for that test. And I heard it's, Cheryl, the first day of your vacation, is that right? Exciting. What a way to start a vacation with an MRI. But we'll be praying for Al in the coming month. The other probably major update I have, Lorena goes in for a procedure tomorrow during the day. 1 p.m. is the procedure in Des Moines. She's in Pella Regional. They'll take her to Des Moines, I think at Methodist, where they're going to remove the fluid that's in her lungs, which will hopefully alleviate the shortness of breath and the nausea and a lot of the other symptoms she's been having over the past week. She's pretty weak. She's not sleeping very well. She's very nauseous. She has to spend most of the day sitting to keep that fluid low. They were supposed to do the procedure this past week, but because she was on blood thinners, they had to wait 5 days. So he'll be taking her by ambulance tomorrow to Des Moines and then bringing her back that same night, at which point they're going to test the fluid and just try to figure out what's going on in her lungs. But it is, there are long days as she just sits in a very uncomfortable hospital chair trying to pass the time. So I know some of you have sent cards and visited and flowers, and she deeply appreciates it. So we'll be praying for Lorena this morning. Are there any other joys or concerns or things you would add to the prayer list this week? One thing I forgot to mention in announcements, the words of hope did come in. That's something else that's usually in the bulletin that I missed. Back there on that back table, if you're one of the people who grabs a Words of Hope devotional, they are on the back table. Any other joys or concerns this morning? If not, I'd invite the praise team to come forward, take a chance to stand and look at somebody else that you haven't greeted yet and smile and just say, boy, I am sure glad you're here with us this morning. Let's stand and worship the Lord together. Children are invited forward this morning for the children's message. Come on down. If you have any coins or bills for the kids, wave them in the air and they'll come and grab them as they come down. Come on down. Oh, good morning. Good morning. We do have a few folks here this morning. Come on. Oh, thank you very much. Another baggie. Deacons love it when you bring a baggie. Thank you, thank you. Oh, my word. Oh, that one has a note attached. I wonder what that's going to say. That'll be fun. Oh, it's a note of how much money's in the bag. The deacons will love that even more. Anybody else? Oh, there's more down the aisle. Oh, people are waving. Does anybody want to run out and grab it? Who's going to help him? He's got it all. Oh, there's more. You guys must be tired this morning. You all just sat down right away. Thank you, thank you. All right. How you guys doing? Yeah? Well, guess what? I thought maybe we were kind of done with the cross pictures, but I still got a few more cross pictures this week. You guys want to see them? Yeah. They're kind of fun. That's kind of a mix of crosses people made and crosses people had. This one is a bunch of Burns kids and Van White kids. They're at a campground. I'm going to hope. Were you you there?
Yeah, but I didn't do that then.
I don't think they made it permanent. I think they just held it up. I'm going to hope they didn't tear a tree out of the ground to make that.
No,
of course not. I bet they found just that big stick on the ground, and they showed us two big sticks. Is the other one? I thought the other one was a tree. Is it just a big stick they're holding up? Okay, two big sticks there. I thought that was great because I go on vacation with my family, and sometimes when you're out in the middle of nowhere, maybe you don't see a church or people you go to church with, and you go, oh, wait, Jesus is still out here even in the wilderness. Yeah.
I made it across the ship when I got
You're going to make, yeah? Very cool. Mail us or email me a picture. We'll put it up there if you make it across. Let's see the next one. Oh, yes. So here's Dave and Karen and their grand boys, Brody on the left and Cooper on the right. And then you see the wonderful, beautiful lady in the bed right there. She's a member of the church, too. Her name is Jan. That's Dave and Patty's mom. And she lives in Altoona. And they have one of the crosses that the men's Bible study made, and then Brody over there has the little cross that we handed out here at church, I think. And I love it when people take crosses or just go and see the people who are living in places and they can't come to church anymore, maybe because they're a little older or they're a little sick, and they maybe think, oh, I wonder if anybody at church remembers me. And then the men's Bible study sent those crosses, and there's a picture of one. We've seen a few of those pictures before. That's pretty awesome. I think we have one more, maybe. Yes, there is one. So that hand belongs to Lorena, who we've been praying for the last few weeks. And if you don't know Lorena, she's the one who works in that office right around the corner out the door. She makes the bulletin and she checks the bathrooms to make sure they have paper towels. I'm going to name everything I've dropped the ball on this week. She puts the consistory things together. She manages all the email communication. She does all kinds of stuff, and she's in the hospital in Pella. And I think one of the Van White girls, I know one of them, I can't remember which one, if it was Hadley or Kinsley, took her this little hand-painted cross. And that's a picture of her hand holding it when they went to visit her. And I loved it because last week, do you guys remember, you colored sheets that we took to Lorena, and she had so much fun. She sat there and went through sheet after sheet after sheet and looked at all the sheets you colored for her, and she really appreciated it. And it made me think, one of the most meaningful and fun ways we can use the cross or prayers or coloring sheets or Jesus in our lives is to reach out to people like Lorena who are having a rough time and just say, hey, we're thinking about you and we're praying for you and we want you to know that God loves you. So here's what I'm going to offer again this week for a challenge. If you guys color your sheets and give them to me, we have a whole bunch of people listed in our bulletin that we've been praying for. I thought it might be fun if we get enough to mail everybody in there one and say, hey, the kids at First Reformed Church are praying for you too, and here's some wonderful coloring that they did. Yeah.
Did you know that last time when my mother and my dad and my brother were here?
Yeah. Oh, yes. We've been sick too, haven't we? I bet how many people up here have ever been sick before and with the flu and gross stuff is happening? Yeah. How many people out there have ever been sick with the flu and gross stuff is happening? 13. Good. That's good to know. What is nice is when you are feeling that bad and somebody reminds you how much they love you and that God loves you. So if you want, you don't have to. You can keep the puzzle or keep the picture, but if you want to give it to me afterwards colored, we'll mail them out to some other folks this week, like Lorena, who will get really cheered up when they see a sheet from you guys, okay? Can we do that? All right, we're going to pray, and then I'll hand out your coloring sheets, which are about a guy named Stephen who had a really, really, really rough time, and yet even when he was having the worst day of his life, he still told Jesus that he loved him. So we'll hand out your coloring sheets, your crayons, and your suckers over there, okay? Let's pray. Dear God, we are remembering today that even if we are having a great day today, even if we get to go out and enjoy the sunshine Even if we get to eat lunch with our families and play at home and relax, there are still lots of people on our prayer list who are maybe not having a good day, who are sick, who are recovering, who are lonely. God, we want to pray for all of those people especially. God, we can take our crosses to all kinds of fun places in the world, but when we take our crosses to those people who aren't feeling good, it is a good reminder that you love them and we love them too. So God, we would pray today that wherever our coloring sheets or crosses end up, they are seen by people who will be happy to remember that they are loved by you. We pray this in your name. And all of God's children said, Amen. God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. He cares for me. He cares for me. He cares for me. He's so good to me. Would you stand as we sing our next song together? Hymn number 349. Oh, for 1,000 tongues to sing. Let's stand and continue to worship God this morning. First passage of scripture today comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 50, verse 20. And we'll read it together, but first, this is kind of towards the end of a very long story. I'm sure most of you are somewhat, if not very familiar of it, but it ties into our new scripture, New Testament scripture so well that I thought it was the best part of the story that would add some color to what comes next today. It is a line spoken by Joseph of amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat fame. Joseph was beaten up, thrown into a hole, and sold into slavery by his jealous brothers. In slavery, he ends up in jail, ends up working for a neighboring king, ends up working his way up to where he's in a respected place within that kingdom. All of this he does because no matter how bad things are going, he keeps his faith in God. And lo and behold, as many of us know, it's a story we learned many times growing up. When a famine hits the lands, he was the one who had the vision to know that they needed to store up grain. And lo and behold, his brothers, thinking he's been killed or sent somewhere else or in jail, having no idea it's him, come to the country to get the grain that he has saved up. And this is what Joseph says to his brothers when they have their first meeting after many, many years. Let's read it together. "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." It is one of many stories in Scripture where we get to see what is often referred to in pop culture as an origin story. A story where you see something big, crazy, traumatic happen to somebody, and then they have a decision on what path in life they're going to take. Joseph, regardless of what came next, put his faith in God. His was a hero's story. I thought, I'm not sure how we do this. I think I'm going to do it by section to make it the most fair, because some of these might be tricky. I know not everyone spent their childhood obsessed by superheroes like I did. I read comic books for a long time in my adolescence, right up until 46 years old last year, I was reading comic books. I have not read any in a year, but man, I would almost bet that people who don't know superheroes would still be so familiar with origin stories that they could almost guess who it is. So if I look at this section and I say, who in this section, raise your hand if you've never seen a single superhero movie. Janet, wink. I don't have my glasses on. That is Janet, right? Janet, if I read this sentence to you, it's somebody's origin story. I'm thinking you could maybe guess who this is. You've never seen a single superhero movie. I don't. Here we go. You ready? There's a sucker in it for you if you get it right. This teenager was bitten by a radioactive spider. Don't help her. Do you know any superheroes that might be spider related? Any men that might be spider related? Any spider related men? What? Okay. I'll throw it out to the rest of the group. Spider-Man. Do I dare ask if there's anyone in this section who's never seen a superhero movie? They're not going to raise their hand now, are they? Arnie. This child's parents were murdered in an alley during a mugging. He grew up to be a superhero. Doesn't know. Batman is correct. Wow, very impressive. Ronald. This baby was sent off his homeworld in a rocket ship just before his planet exploded. You could just throw a superhero out. Any man that seems super to you, you could just say any super man you can think of. Superman is correct! Wow, you guys are smarter than I thought. I have a whole bunch of these, and I'm not going to do more than four, because this is... Who in this section knows their superheroes? Who's like, I got them all? Dave? Sandy Wagaman? Dave. These four brothers, ready? We're living in a sewer. Ninja Turtles are correct, Dave. Yes. You want to go for bonus?
Sure. Two
suckers? Sure. This man found a dying alien who gave him a powerful green ring that it could be charged with a lantern. Green Lantern is correct. Give him a round of applause. Two in a row. Here's the hard one. Probably my favorite. What?
Three suckers
if he gets this right. Iron Man is incorrect. No, don't. I don't like pre-guessing. This hero got his powers by standing next to a shelf full of chemicals when he was struck by lightning. Oh. The Joker is incorrect. But it does worry me that you consider the Joker a hero, Dave. Anybody know that one? The Flash is correct. The Flash is correct. Mary. What I always loved about comic books, and still love to a certain extent, is they are quick to point out that not just heroes have origin stories. And the origin stories of almost all the heroes is something terrible or tragic. Kind of like when you watch Disney or Pixar movies, the main character is often coming off a terrible tragedy. And what comic books are so good at pointing out is the villains that they're fighting also have an origin story. And sometimes the origin story of the villains is something not even as bad as the origin story of the heroes. But at some point, both the hero and the villain took whatever tragedy came in their life and made a decision with how to use it. I said last week we were done talking about the Holy Spirit, but I misspoke because I found another story to close out with. We're going to read John 15, chapter 15, verses 26 through 27. Let's read them together as a congregation. This is Jesus again talking to us about some of the attributes of the Holy Spirit that he is sending. Together. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning. One of the attributes of the Holy Spirit that Jesus tells us is coming is that of the witness. The Holy Spirit will testify to what God has done and what has been seen by God in our world, and the Holy Spirit will also give us the power to testify. We're going to read one of those testimonies today from the book of Acts. This is a whole bunch of scripture that I knew in my head. As much as I would love to stand here and read 40 or 50 verses, that often doesn't go well on a Sunday morning with people who've maybe had a long week. So I'm going to give you a little bit of backstory before we get to the chunk we are going to read. The Holy Spirit has been spilled out over the people at Pentecost. People are now traveling all over the place, talking about God, talking about Jesus, giving their testimonies of what Jesus did for us and who they were after they met Jesus. We are reading a portion today about a martyr named Stephen, someone who gave their life for the faith. Stephen was one of the people filled by the Holy Spirit who immediately went out into the world and began to tell everybody the love that Jesus has for us. It made a lot of the religious figures angry, and they thought he was causing too much of a commotion, and this is not the way that they'd run the temple and religion for thousands of years. And so some of them lied and said that Stephen was blaspheming God, saying things that were untrue about God. And they arrested him, and they brought him before the council for trial. And Stephen, just before the portion we're going to read today, gives them a speech. And what's kind of fun about the speech is it's a kind of speech that many people have given in Scripture before him. Kind of the, hey, I'm going to give you a brief history of where God started and where we are now with God. But Stephen picks very specific people from Scripture to talk about. He talks about Abraham, who was kind of an idol-worshipping nobody who God challenged to become a stranger in a strange land, who in his very senior age found out he was going to have children. He talks about Moses, who was abandoned as a baby, became a murderer on the run. He talks about Joseph, who we just read about, who was sold into slavery and ended up overcoming it. He talks about David, who was the runt of a family who wanted so badly to build this temple for God, but it ended up his son built it. He specifically mentions all these followers of God who had some pretty traumatic things happen to them. He could have named a lot more people in the history of Scripture. But he kind of singles out these specific heroes and their stories. We start with verse 51 in chapter 7. This is the end of his speech after he's given them an extended history lesson. Stephen says, "You stiff-necked people with uncircumcised hearts and ears." Circumcision is still the tradition of the day that if you wanted to prove you were a follower of God, you were circumcised. Stephen is saying it doesn't matter what you've physically done to yourself. God can see that your hearts have not been circumcised. You have not made that sacrifice of heart to give yourself to God. You're just like your fathers. You always resist the Holy Spirit. Was there ever a prophet your fathers did not persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one. And now you have betrayed and murdered him. You who have received the law that was put into effect through angels, but have not obeyed it. Chastising them, saying, it's funny how every time somebody comes along to preach the will of God, the word of God, the love of God, you get uncomfortable and you kill them. All the way back through history, right up to the Son of God, you're not catching on to what the Holy Spirit's trying to do. When they heard this, they were furious and gnashed their teeth at him. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." At this, they covered their ears, and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed at him, dragged him out of the city, and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he fell on his knees and cried out, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he fell asleep. And Saul was there, giving approval to his death. On that day, a great persecution broke out against the church at Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. Godly men buried Stephen and mourned deeply for him, but Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off men and women and put them in prison. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A very painful, terrible, tragic ending to the life of Stephen. And all he did was profess the love of Jesus Christ right up until his death, with his last words doing the same thing Jesus did, looking at the people around him who were filled with evil intent and murderous thoughts and saying to God, "God, I'm still asking that you forgive them. Don't hold this sin against them." It is one of those moments in Scripture where physically on earth there was literally nothing good happening. The only believer is being stoned to death. He's surrounded by a mob of angry, evil murderers. And yet one of the main themes that runs through that short story of Stephen is he is plugged in directly to the Holy Spirit. Even when this is the worst, most painful, most agonizing day of his life, because of the Holy Spirit, he does not see the present. He sees the future. He sees where he is going. He sees God and he sees Jesus at his right hand. And he's the only one in the crowd who sees it. The rest actually cover their ears and refuse to hear. And then at the end of that story, we get the beginning of someone else's origin story. A lot of times when we talk about Saul, the Christian killer who would go on to become Paul, the preacher, and go on to write many of the texts we read in the New Testament, we think about him walking down that road when Jesus confronts him from the heavens and says, "Why are you persecuting me?" And we see him guiltily fall down and give his life to Christ and turn over a new leaf. Many people would consider maybe that's Saul slash Paul's origin story, but actually we see his origin story here. He is watching the coats of those who murder Stephen. He is in the presence of the Holy Spirit at work, even when he doesn't realize it. Stephen is dying and offers a prayer to everyone around him, including Saul. Stephen has no idea what his prayer or what the Holy Spirit will do next. He goes to his death just trusting. Even when everything is out of control in the worst possible ways, God is still in control in the best possible ways. And as you continue on to watch Saul, you realize that that moment of brushing up against the Holy Spirit begins a journey for him that leads directly to Christ. I have a feeling if you went back and you said to Stephen, "Stephen, you're going to get murdered terribly and violently. They're going to stone you to death in the middle of the street. It's going to be painful and agonizing, and the last eyes you see will all be unfriendly murderers." If you showed him an exact picture of what was going to be his end, but then said to him, "But don't worry, you see this murderer over here, your death is going to have an impact on him," might not have made Stephen feel great in the moment. He didn't know God's plan. He didn't know where the Spirit would lead next when he was killed. All he knew in that moment was, "I'm going to trust what the Spirit is showing me in this moment. I'm going to turn my eyes to God and pray for those around me." Could he have made a different choice? Yes. The Bible is filled with people on the other side who made the opposite choice. All the way back to Cain and Abel, we see how often in Scripture there are two parallel people who make the exact opposite choice when it comes to the Spirit of God. You see Moses and you see Pharaoh. You see King David and you see King Saul. You see Matthew the tax collector, and you see Judas Iscariot. You see all these pairs of people. Rahab, the prostitute who protected God's spies. Jezebel, the queen who wanted to kill God's people. You see all these people who are faced with similar tragedy, similar pain, similar pressure, similar sin, similar death, similar evil. And yet one person will make a choice one way and the other person makes a choice another way. And when you read comic books long enough and you read Scripture long enough and you read most literature long enough, you realize that everybody has an origin story, and at some point there comes a moment in their life when they make a decision which way they're going to handle their pain. Stephen chose to rely on the Spirit in the moment, even though he had no clue what was going to happen. Matthew chose to give up his greed at the side of the road. Judas chose to hold on to it in the end. Part of what the Holy Spirit does for us is it reminds us in those moments that even if you don't know what God is doing in your life during the midst of whatever's going on, if you trust in the Holy Spirit, you are choosing the path of God's kingdom. If in those moments you abandon the Spirit of God, you go down the other path. And God has told us that other path always ends in death, physically, mentally, spiritually. But if you choose to follow the Spirit, it always ends in life. No matter what they do to your body, or your money, or your friends, or your family, the Spirit of God will always lead to the eternal kingdom. In Stephen's moments, that's all he knew at the end. If I keep my eyes on God and Christ, regardless of what happens in this moment, the kingdom will move forward. We'll read more later about Saul, who, even though he was there to witness that moment, had no idea what that moment of his story was going to mean for him later on. One of the things that we can hold on to of the Holy Spirit is that it is the witness for us that when we face those hard moments in life, we can be reminded of all the heroes who came before. We can be reminded of the woman who washed the feet of Jesus in the midst of an angry room of elders. We can remember the story of the leper who, as he was painfully dying day by day of his life, chose to call out to Jesus and to thank him for the love that God gave him. We can think of the fact that in the midst of this terrible moment in history of Stephen being stoned to death, surrounded by some of the most evil people on earth, he had no idea that when we read, everybody scatters. All the followers of God begin to take off in fear and they run. That what those people who were killing him to try to silence him didn't understand was they were beginning an exodus of people who had a witness of Jesus Christ in their hearts. And as they started running from town to town to escape what happened to Stephen, they were actually going out as evangelists to tell people about the love of God. You might have intended harm, but God took the harm and the evil that was done and transformed it into something beautiful. This is the work of the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come to you this morning, it is easier and easier to see in our lives the amount of things that are going wrong, the amount of ways that we want to give up or give in, the negativity that can creep into our souls, the way we can give ourselves over to hopelessness. And yet, God, when we stop and listen to the Holy Spirit, the Spirit will remind us that throughout the very history of this universe, all the way back to creation, you had the ability to transform ugliness and sin into beauty and forgiveness. So God, we would pray for the hearts of Joseph this morning, the heart of Stephen, the heart that regardless of what is going on, we smile and we look to you. And we know that whatever this world is throwing at us, you are far more powerful and far more in control. We can read through your scriptures and see countless men and women who in the worst moments of their lives gave themselves over to you fully, and your kingdom explodes and more people are reached, more souls are saved, more love is given, more sins are forgiven. God, we know this morning, even though our list of prayer concerns is long and seems to be added to every week, God, we know the witness of your Spirit, that you hear our prayers. You comfort those who are in need, whether it be with a grandchild or a painted rock or a kind doctor or a caring nurse or visits from friends or family or from a sheet that's colored by a child, by a Bible verse that springs to your heart when you feel like hope is lost. God, we know that when we tune into your Spirit, you give us vision beyond what is currently surrounding us. You remind us what is coming in the end. You remind us of the eternal homecoming and the plan to spread your good news to all your children. God, hear our prayers this morning for the Samsons and the Springers and the Lorenz families. God, we know the grief that death can bring. We know that if we look at that as the end of all, there is no hope. But God, we put our faith in you and we trust when you say death is not the end. And so God, we would pray that you would comfort those three families and their communities as they grieve the loss of loved ones this week, and remind them that your Spirit is within them and around them and continuing to do your work. God, hear our prayers for Bob and his family and friends as he draws closer to home. God, we would pray for an ease to his discomfort. We would pray for his wife as she cares for him. God, hear our prayers for the Abbots, for safe travels as they head back down to Texas. Lord, we would pray this week with Peter would be an amazing, love-filled week of fun and security and family. We would pray your Spirit would pour into them the goodness of your love. God, we continue to pray for Allison, healing after her surgery. Continue to pray for Phyllis as she continues to recover after her last treatment. God, we continue to pray for Lowell and the difficulty of his journey over the last months. God, hear our prayers for Al and Cheryl as he waits more than a month to find more answers. Lord, give him the patience to hold on tightly to your Spirit, who has so faithfully walked him through the last 18 years and will walk him through the rest of his life. God, hear our prayers for Lorena. Lord, we know you're close to her at this moment. We know her heart so desperately hates to sit and wait and do nothing. We know how frustrated she probably is as she tries to remain patient and strong. But God, we also know that her trust is so fully and deeply in you. We know that you will find ways in the coming days to comfort her, to remind her that you are on this journey with her. We pray for her as she heads to her procedure tomorrow, that would be successful. They would be able to remove that fluid from her lungs, that she would be able to breathe and sleep and eat and start feeling better. God, we don't know what will come from day to day for Lorena, Kurt, or Jordan, or all those other names we don't even name out loud this morning that weigh on our hearts. But we do know that when we hear your Spirit and we refuse to give up on the vision of the love of Jesus Christ, this world can be changed. This world can be relieved. This world can be forgiven. This world can be healed. So Lord, again, we turn to you and we ask that you would fill this congregation and this community with the Holy Spirit in ways that we could not even imagine. That in our most trying moments, we simply look to you. And know that you will handle the bigger plan. God, as we come to you this week, we know part of handing ourselves over fully into your plan is to offer all of those things in our lives that distract us, hold us back, keep us up at night. God, we have spoken words that have been hurtful. We've committed actions that we know are sins. We have thought thoughts that we are ashamed to admit. And yet, God, we know that if we offer those to you, we have already heard. Your Spirit was working in our hearts, drawing us close to you to repent and ask forgiveness, understanding the promise that you would remove those sins from us. You would help us carry our burdens, that the love Jesus Christ had for the lowest in this world is the same love he has for us now. And so we close this prayer with the words that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Please rise for our benediction, and then the praise team will close us out with our last song this morning. As you leave this house of worship today and go back to your weekly lives, whether it be family or work or vacation or sports or wherever you go, this is the reminder, this is the work of the Holy Spirit within us, that at any moment when you are confused or in pain or angry or upset or lost in this world, hear the Holy Spirit speaking in your heart, that even when you cannot see it or understand it, at every single moment, God is still at work. Keep your eyes on the Son. Go in peace. Amen.